extremely valuable. He worked as chief scientist and head of Center for Lipid Research from Indian Institute of Chemical Technology, a CSIR lab based in Hyderabad. I request RBN sir to please take over and welcome our audiences and give them a brief glimpse about what this seminar is about. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Radhika. So once again, good morning to all. So it's my really very, very pleasant duty and also pleasure to welcome you all for this two-day virtual seminar on behalf of Royal Society of Chemistry, Local Deccan Section. So my special welcome to Professor B.L.V. Prasad, Director of CENS Bangalore, and all the colleagues of CENS. I also welcome our RSC colleagues, Professor Pisapati, Dr. Radhika, Dr. C. Lakshmi, Dr. Elamgad, and all other EC members. I also welcome the student community. So it's a very huge student community, and also some faculty members who are participating in this seminar, in this virtual seminar. So first of all, I must really compliment Dr. C.V. Elamgad for taking this initiative and organizing this seminar, which is very, very useful for the student community. As all of us know, for the last 1.5 years, we are facing a very, very, very difficult time due to the present pandemic. And particularly student community is facing a very difficult situation. So that's the reason this type of virtual seminars are really important to motivate and inspire the student community. Actually, due to this reason, RSC is taking a lot of initiatives in organizing this type of seminars by joining hands with several organizations. So this particular seminar, as all of you know, this is on nano and soft materials for societal needs. So it provides a great opportunity for students and faculty to get the feel of the developments of the nanotechnology. As all of us know, nanotechnology is very, very, what you call, very, very crucial today. Imagine without the nanotechnology today, what would have happened to this world because of this pandemic? So whatever you really touch, so everywhere, whatever we are using, your computers, sunscreens, even now it's really going on like clothing, furniture, adhesives, everything, like even tennis balls. So everything is really what you call, no? Being dependent by or fine-tuned by or developed by, or particularly it's that they're being really making so wonderful, making use of the nanotechnology. So actually we're so fortunate for this two-day symposium, virtual seminar, we have four great speakers. So today, the first lecture is by Professor B.L.V. Prasad. He's none other than the director of CNS Bangalore. He's speaking on dressed to function nanoparticle synthesis, surface modification applications. Today, as we are really waiting for your lecture, sir. So the second lecture is Dr. H.S.S.R. Mate. Again, he is also a scientist in CENS Bangalore. He is speaking on nanoscience, the new and big science of small. So, and today these two lectures we have, and tomorrow we have two other lectures. The first lecture is by Dr. C.V. Elamgad, who is also a scientist of CENS Bangalore, and also he is also very active in our RSC local Deccan section. And he is speaking on liquid crystals, the new soft matter fundamental aspects. The second lecture tomorrow will be on Dr. S. Krishna Prasad. He is the scientist, again from CENS Bangalore. He will be speaking on multidimensional technological applications of liquid crystals. So particularly for the student community, I think it's a great feast. So at the end of today's two lectures, they really take you to the world of nanotechnology. And particularly the title itself is really telling that these nano and soft materials for societal needs, which has got so much of applied vertical applications, because students, they read so much in the textbooks about nanotechnology and other things like bookish. But particularly this particular conference, it really provides a real, what you call, see-through in the world, particularly how the nanotechnology is being really used for societal needs. I think it's a great opportunity for all of us to listen. and including me, I am also really looking forward to really what you call listen all these four speakers. And I think with these few remarks, I now really what you call now welcome all of you once again for this wonderful virtual seminar. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for those very informative words, sir, for the advantage of all the participants who are listening so intently. Now I call upon Professor V. Pisapati Garu, Special Advisor, Royal Society of Chemistry, Local Section, Deccan. Now, whatever I tell about this person would be little short of the actual.
Amma.
Yes, sir.
Amma. 1 minute, Dr. Radhika.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Sir.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Ma, Dr. Ganguly is going to discuss about the RSC.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, so so Pisapati Garu has been involved with RSC. In fact, he is one person who has brought local section Deccan to what position today it is. He is our special advisor, and he has been, he is a renowned professor, researcher involved in establishing pharmaceutical labs of national repute. Now I request Dr. Ganguly Pintu, who is also our vice president, vice chairman of Royal Society of Chemistry, London, for giving a brief idea of what this Royal Society is all about and what do we do in general at the world level, at the national level, and at the local section, Deccan level. So I request Professor Ganguly to please take over.
Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, very good morning, Professor Pisapati, and thank you, Radhika Madam, for giving me this opportunity to present and talk about RSC and our local Deccan section. A very good morning to our Chairman, Dr. R.B. Prasad, the faculty from Center for Nano and Soft Matter Science, and all the faculty of P.C. Jabin Science College, Hubli. I think a very warm welcome and very good morning to all of you. Now, will I be able to present a small PDF file? Is it possible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you will need to just give me
the. Yes, sir. I have given the permission.
Okay.
Yes, sir. It is given.
Just a minute, let me. So is my desktop screen visible?
No, sir.
It may take a minute, but in the meantime, let me start. Talking about what RSC is all about. I think, let me know if the screen is still not visible.
It's not visible, sir. But at the center, there is option share screen.
Okay, let me
please click that, sir.
Just a minute, I think. Still not visible?
No, sir.
okay, what I will do, I will speak about RSC, and I think that should, because I don't want to lose any more time. So, and then I think if that is audible, I think we should be fine. So RSC is a pretty old chemistry organization, one of the topmost NGOs in UK, established in 1841 with almost 180 years of history. And RSC has in it, it has been having many of the Nobel laureates as members, as fellows. And as we also know that a fellowship, elected fellowship of RSC is a very coveted honor, even for Indian scientists, for Indian top academicians. So what does RSC does? So RSC connects scientists with each other and society as a whole, so they can do their best work and make discoveries and innovations. RSC publishes new research, develops, recognizes, and celebrates professional capabilities, brings people together to spark new ideas and new partnerships. RSC supports teachers to inspire future generations of scientists. And RSC also speaks up to influence policies. So it has several roles. So in essence, what RSC says is that we are catalysts of the chemistry that enriches the world. So professional body of chemists and scientists coming together to advance chemistry across the world. In its different other activities that RSC has, one of the very popular and very well-known activities about publishing. RSC publishes several journals across the world. And in the last several years, from 2015, India and Indian scientists have been the second most important contributor to the RSC journals. So it's a great achievement for Indian scientists and Indian academia that we figure very prominently in most of these very prestigious RSC journals that are published. RSC conducts conferences and events. As I mentioned, it is a body of learned society. It facilitates education, science policy, and it's also a professional body for awarding certifications. And it has presence across 125 countries. Now, coming to what we do in the RSC Deccan section, in India, we have five local sections. That Indian office was established, the RSC Indian office was established in 2014. And RSC, the local sections have been doing phenomenal work across the country. And particularly under the leadership of Professor Pisapati and now currently Radhika Madam, we have been doing wonderful work in and around the southern region, which comprises the Deccan section. So we conduct seminars, competition, hands-on experiential programs for students, conducting practicals. We are also collaborating with several NGOs to inspire teachers to conduct some of these programs in rural areas, so that students from rural background can benefit. So these are some of the activities that we are doing, and we are feedback to find out how we can expand to help educate and help teachers, help students in this process of learning chemistry. With this, I will wish this online seminar a great success, and it will be also, as Dr. Prasad also mentioned, it will be nice for me to be also listening to some of these top scientists talking about nanoscience and the subject that we have taken for this online seminar. So thank you so much, and then wish this event and wish this college and wish our all our students benefit from this online seminar, and we have a great 2 days. Thank you
very much, Dr. Ganguly Garu, for your great inputs on what RSC does. I think in this contest, I will not be amiss if I request all the students and the teachers present here, those who are involved in chemistry, to become members of RSC. It's one of those old established organizations which are doing a lot in order to encourage students take interest in chemistry. So this is one call from all of us to see that you enroll yourself and get the benefits. Because all the senior teachers, like you are able to see Dr. Ganguly here, Dr. P. Sapati, Dr. R.B.N. Prasad, Dr. Yellamgad, all these people are there to guide and help you. So students, take the opportunity, don't miss it. Now, as a next part of the program, I invite Dr. D.S. Shankar Rao Garu, who is a senior scientist, Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, Bangalore. He is taking up the position of the coordinator, its outreach activities. And I must thank you, sir, for your help, support, and guidance to organize this program. I request you to say a few words.
Thank you very much, madam. First of all, I want to thank all the RSC members, Dr. Radhika madam, Dr. R.B.N. Prasad, Dr. Elamagar, and all the members of the RSC for including the CNS in this program. And a brief mention about our V4 activity. Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, that is called as SENS. It's a leading research institute that is devoted to the research in the area of nanomaterials, that is nanoscale materials, that is of relevance in a variety of applications. And also it conducts research in the field of soft matter, that is a prime example of which is liquid crystals that form the inseparable component of our present digital society. And the uniqueness of SENS, it lies in research that is being carried out to realize smart nanosoft materials emerging from the judicious combination of best of these two fields. And about the V4 activity, CNS is embarking on science initiation program that is aimed at the students. So under this program, CNS is inviting small group of high school students plus two students for half a day visit here in the campus. So they participate in the science learning activities that includes lab tours and then brief inspiring talk by one of our faculty members, and then in-house demonstration of the simple scientific experiment, which will create curiosity among these students. And we also do the lecture plus demonstration outside the campus also, so at various schools. And apart from this, there is one more kind of program. So this includes induce and generate the young minds an aptitude of relating daily scientific principles, and at the same time to appreciate the importance of scientific research. So I was mentioning about the third program wherein some 3-4 faculty, we go outside, we give a lecture and also conduct a quiz on this nanosoft materials create the scientific awareness, scientific interest among the students. So this is about the brief mention of about our V4 activities. So V4 means Vidyarthi, Vignani Vidyarthi, Vichara Samagama. So yeah, there I want to end my time. Yeah. Thank you very much. Yes.
Okay. Shankara, can you ask them? Let me. I try to ask them to join.
the host is
thank you, Dr. Shankar Garu, for elaborately explaining to us what your organization does, Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences. We must personally thank you for the masks that you have made and popularized. I think most of us are using those masks because we find them very, very comfortable and very protective. Thank you once again, sir.
And I just want to include one last sentence. So due to this pandemic, our activity is restricted to online scientific talk. And
Can you please let me in
Professor BLV Prashad? Admit.
I'm trying to join in. So,
madam, please admit Dr. Professor BLV Prashad.
Yes, sir. It is admitted, sir. RBN Prashad, sir.
Not RBN, sir. Not RBN, sir.
CNS Director, Professor BLV Prashad.
Just written as BLV Prashad, CNS.
It is written as BLV Prashad CNS. So
just for you.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, BLV Prashad, sir, requested to unmute, sir. BLV Prashad, sir, please requested to unmute yourself.
Unmute yourself, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, sir. Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can you decrease that? Can you please activate the CNS discussion? Don't unmute that.
Yes.
Please allow CNS discussion, yes, sir. As a participant.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. He's also unmuted, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
Please bear with us for 2 minutes. Shall I speak now?
Radhika madam,
are you able to hear me now?
Sir, you have to unmute yourself, sir. You are mute. Yeah, we are able to hear you, sir.
Yeah, now we are able to hear you, sir.
Thank you. And there is no echo, no other problem, right?
No, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. So I'm ready.
Yes,
sir. You say.
Radhika madam, go ahead with the program. Next program, please.
Thank you for coming in, sir, for your enthusiasm and support. Now I request the backbone of this entire program, without whose support and hard work we could not be sitting here having such a wonderful program, Dr. L.D. Horakeri, Principal, P.C. Jabin Science College. He is one senior professor who has been involved in KLE society activities from quite some time. He has taken the mantle of such a big responsibility of being the principal of such a well-known college. I wish you all the best, sir, for your tenure as a principal. And thank you very much for helping us to host this and reach out to your students and staff with all our experts and with all our experts to see that we ignite that spark in them to learn, go into the field of chemistry. I request Dr. L.D. Horakeri, sir, to please take over.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for your kind words, madam. Thank you. Thank you very much, madam. Thank you for your kind words, madam. Good morning to one and all present over here. I, Dr. L.D. Hurkeri, principal of PC Jobin Science College, heartily welcome all the renowned scientists who are present over here from Royal Society of Chemistry and Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences. Mr. V. Pisa, Mr. R.B. and Prasad, Chairman R.S.C., Mr. D.S. Chikrao, Mr. D.L. Vipinathar, Dr. H.S. Ramakrishna Matte, Dr. C.V. Yelmakkad, our proud alumni of our sister institution, H.S. Kothambri Science Institute, Hubballi, Dr. S. Krishna Prasad, Dr. Srimati K.R. Radhika, Professor Ganguly, sir, and all my colleague friends, and all my dear student friends, we have joined this 2 days online seminar. So once again, welcome you all to this online seminar. So it gives me a great pleasure to say few words about KLE Society and our prestigious PC Jobin Science College, Hubballi. KLE Society is a premier educational society started in the year 1916 by 7 dedicated teachers whom we respectfully call them as Saptarshis. Now the society is running 275 plus educational institutions all around the globe under the able, dynamic and strong leadership of our Honorable Chairman Sir, Dr. Prabhakar Koreji, well supported by the Board of Management, Board of Life Members, Executive Body of KLE Society, Belagavi. The KLE success story of 10 decades speaks volumes of dedication and commitment of thousands of people transforming lives through education. A hub of more than 275 institutions that offers and disseminates the knowledge in all spheres of education for overall development of the students. It promotes and encourages the student community to opt for programs like medicine, dentistry, pharmacy, nursing, agriculture, law, business management, hotel management, engineering and technology, basic sciences, arts, commerce, and education. In pursuit of higher excellence in the fields of health and technology, the society has established KLE Health University at Belagavi and KLE Technological University at Hubballi. These universities have collaborations with universities in US, UK, and Malaysia, and have added new dimensions to the society, making it on par with reputed educational institutes worldwide. More than 125,000 students and 16,000 dedicated faculty have contributed in making the society an international education destination. So PC Jobin Science College, Hubballi, a prestigious institute of KLE Society, has contributed and excelled in imparting quality science education in north part of Karnataka since its inception in the year 1957. This is the first college to voluntarily undergo NAAC assessment and accredited with 4 stars in the year 1999. Subsequently, A grade in the 4th cycle with the CGPA of 3.43 in 2017. Recognizing the quality of education rendered by the college, the UGC has granted autonomous status in 2007 and extended it in the year 2012 and 2018. Based on the excellent performance in the academics, research, and concern for community, the UGC has recognized our college as college with potential for excellence in the year 2007 and continued second and third phase with a grant of 100 lakhs in each phase. The research unit of the college is contributing remarkably in the areas of cancer biology, tissue culture, spectroscopy, material sciences, and kinetics. Faculty and students were able to publish and present their research output at international and national level. The college is now taking strides towards networking with different national and international bodies. The efforts have paid off as many of our students have been recruited by multinational companies like Infosys, Wipro, Nestle, L&T, Tech Mahindra, Accenture, IBM, TCS and Sankalpa Semiconductors. So KLE Society's PC Jobin Science College is a reputed science institution imparting quality science education. The college, on its way of success, has been awarded autonomy by UGC to provide need-based employable courses and curriculum. Besides excelling in academic activities, our students have been excelling in co-curricular and extracurricular activities. They have represented the college at the university, state, national, and international levels. The efforts of the students and the guidance by our well-experienced, dedicated staff have been collectively responsible for the progress of the college. In the days to come, the college is planning to enhance post-graduation courses, research, and training for competitive examinations. The developmental activities of the college are spurred by the Board of Management of KLE Society, Belagavi, under the dynamic chairmanship of our chairman, Dr. Prabhakar B. Koreji. Their invaluable support has been leading the college to the heights of success. We are moving with a vision to implant knowledge to face the global challenge. So with these few words, I am requesting all of you to visit our college as soon as the situation eases. So this is the standing invitation for all of you renowned scientists from Royal Society of Chemistry and Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences. So with these few words, I once again welcome you all to this 2 days online seminar on nano and soft materials for societal needs. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Harikeri Garu. It's really extremely impressive performance by your college, sir. We are all considering it a privilege to be associated with such a reputed institute doing well all round. It's an extremely impressive achievement, sir. Congratulations to you for all your NAC accreditations and Center for Excellence grants. Hearty congratulations from all of us. I hope that from here we take on an associate in order to benefit the students whom you and us both are striving to take them to a great heights. Thank you once again, sir, for helping us organize this in association with your reputed institution. Thanks a lot. Now we launch into the program of the scientific lectures by all the speakers involved. The first person, obviously, is the director, Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, Professor B.L.V. Prasad Garu. I must tell all the participants sitting here the eagerness and the humility with which he has accepted our invitation in the first request. He has been extremely kind to tell us how things are going to move, and very, very helpful, because his goal, like ours, is the same: to bring up sciences in our country, so that like sports is shining today, tomorrow the people from chemistry should shine at the international level. Thank you very much, sir, for your enthusiasm, for your hard work, support, and guidance in this particular program. And I am sure all the people who have gathered here, around 500, some through the Zoom, some through the YouTube channel, and some are sitting in the auditorium, so we don't get their numbers in the Zoom link. So everybody sitting here knows about Professor Prasad Garu, but still, to know why he is where he is right now, the amount of hard work that he has put in, the amount of achievements that he has under his belt, and how we as a country value such people will be explained to you by Dr. Shweta J. Sabanwar. I request Dr. Shweta to formally introduce Professor B.L.V. Prasad Garu to the entire audience. Welcome, Dr. Shweta.
Thank you, ma'am. A very good morning to one and all. It's my great honor and pleasure to introduce the keynote speaker, Professor B.L.V. Prasad. Professor Prasad is the director at Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, Bengaluru, and also working as a senior principal scientist, physical and materials Chemistry Division at CSIR, National Chemical Laboratory, Pune, India. Sir completed schooling and early education in Vijayawada, Andhra Pradesh. Later, moved to Hyderabad Central University and obtained Master of Science and PhD degrees in chemistry. He started working in the area of nanomaterials during the two postdoctoral stints. One at Tokyo Institute of Technology with 2 years of Japan Society for Promotion of Science Fellowship and 1 year as Research Associateship. Second at Kansas State University, which had a sponsorship by NASA. Later, joined National Chemical Laboratory in 2003. His group is actively working in the general area of material synthesis and in particular nanoparticles and nanoscale materials. Sir has published more than 125 papers in international peer-reviewed journals and has 8 international patents to add on to his credit. Sir was invited as visiting professor by different universities in many countries. With this brief introduction, I would like to request Professor Prasad to begin the session. Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
We can hear you.
Okay. Good morning to you all, and many thanks for having me in this outreach program being organized by the Royal Society of Chemistry Deccan Local Section. I would like to thank Professor R.B.N. Prasad, the chairman of Local Section Deccan, the secretary, Dr. Radhika, and of course, Dr. Horakeri, the principal of PCJIN College, Hubballi, who is organizing this program. Thanks for having me here. And I should also thank all my colleagues at CENS who are organizing this program. I joined CENS recently, but they have been doing this outreach program in a very, very systematic and a very enthusiastic way. They have been doing this program with a lot of zeal and enthusiasm, and that is very clear in the lot of programs that they organize. Unfortunately, due to the pandemic, we are not able to have many other things that we used to do, especially having people on our campus or having going there and then demonstrating the experiments, which are actually very important when you speak of outreach programs. Nonetheless, even the online platforms are sometimes very useful to conduct these programs. So let me straight away go ahead and then start sharing my screen and then making the presentation that I want to make. 1 minute, just give me a minute. Is my screen visible now? You are?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I also must say that we are basically celebrating what is called the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. In next year, 2022 August, we'll be completing 75 years of our independence. And the government has asked us, especially all the scientific organizations, to run big programs around this. So we basically dedicate this particular lecture also to those events that have been as part of this Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. So, again, thanks to RSC Deccan Section and the KNG Society, PC Jagan College for allowing us to organize this lecture as part of that program. And of course, all my colleagues at CENS Bangalore who have helped me in doing that. So I have selected a slightly popular title. I felt yesterday when Dr. Elamagad, who is actually is the force behind me accepting this invitation, saying that you should definitely speak here. I should thank him also. When he asked me to speak, I asked him who will be the audience, and then he said mostly BSc students. But yesterday he told me there are 110 faculty members also, and probably many other who are watching on the YouTube. who are belonging to the expert group in the area of nanomaterials. So for them, my talk would be little, you know, at a very fundamental and basic level, and at a popular type kind of a journal. So please excuse me, all the experts should excuse me if my topic looks too simple and then, like, you know, too mundane to all of you. So to make the students kind of, you know, be interested in this kind of a thing, I chose a very slightly popular kind of a title called Dress to Function, which is basically the nanoparticle synthesis, surface modification and application. So therefore, what I will be doing is I will be particularly giving a lot of analogies, linking our daily observations or daily things that we see with respect to our dressing that we do. Now, and then, you know, tell how that is related to this nanoparticle synthesis and surface modification with respect to your particular application. Whenever you have an application in mind, you need to prepare the nanomaterials in a particular way, or at least modify them in a particular way so that they are suitable for their application. So this is an extremely important aspect, and I will be highlighting that part as much as possible during my talk. So this particular title is basically kind of was inspired by this Hollywood film. There are two films actually, 1941 in one, and then 1918 in another one, called Dress to Kill. Of course, we are not going to kill anyone today, but you know, we are basically trying to do some function. Okay. If any one of the students are, you know, feeling bored, so there is a link given at the bottom to this movie. If you are an Amazon Prime member, you can go and watch this movie and not this lecture. Right? Feel free to do that. Okay. So, of course, now I'm going to talk about nanomaterials, because my other colleagues will be talking about soft matter, but I will be mostly talking about nanomaterials, and of course, followed by my other colleague, Dr. Ramakrishna Mathe next. Right? But when we say nano, so there is obviously, most of you must have heard so many talks on nano by this time. So all of you know what is nano, more or less, like now all of you know why it is so important. But one thing that, you know, many people, when I still ask some question, I don't know, I thought I will, you know, make this a little more interactive. I asked a few students, I hope they are available, you know, Rakeshri, Praveen, etc., etc. Occasionally, I might ask them some questions. So please be, you know, available, right? So when we say nano, obviously, the scientific definition of this nano is given there, which is nothing but this 10 power minus 9, right? But 10 power minus 9, what? And then why we should worry about that, right? And so which way nano we should worry about? In scientific terms, obviously, there are three different units that we talk about, which are given at the bottom. One is the time, the other one is the length, and the other one, the third one is the weight, okay? So can anyone, you know, Bhagyashri or Praveen, can you tell me which one, which nano we should worry about if you are online? Should I worry about the time? And therefore, that means I should worry about nanosecond. Should I worry about nanometer length? Or should I worry about nanogram? Which one relates to nanoscience and technology the way we are talking about?
Nanogram.
Okay. Interesting, right? Okay. So obviously the answer is nanometer. Okay. So when we are talking about nanoscience and technology, we are talking about nanometer. But the question then comes out, why should we worry about only nanometer? Why should not we worry about nanosecond? Why should not we worry about nanogram? Right? Okay. So I think, so I can also move the cursor. So why are we not worried about nanosecond, or why are we not worried about nanogram, and why are we so particular about nanometer only, right? So if you really look at it, and we will not have much of a time to go through it. So one of the reasons why we say nano is so important, or we give so much of importance to nano, is that when we say nano, it means small, right? So nano means small. There is a car that is very small, so we call it nano, nano car, right? That car is called nano. Now you can mute your mics, Praveen and Bhagyashri. So when it comes to time scale, is nano small? In fact, in time scale, the smallest times that right now we can access to or achieve are somewhere around octoseconds. There are octosecond lasers available that can allow you to study processes occurring at femtoseconds. For example, a chemical bond formation is known to occur at femtosecond time scale. What is a femtosecond? A femtosecond is 10 power minus 15. And an attosecond is 10 power minus 18. So which are basically another 6 orders of magnitude or 9 orders of magnitude smaller than nano, right? So if you want to say how many femtoseconds are there in a nanosecond, there will be 10 power 6 femtoseconds. 10 power 6 is not small. If how many attoseconds are there in a nanosecond, there will be 10 power 9 attoseconds in one nanosecond. So these numbers are not small. So nanosecond doesn't appear to be small, right? So therefore, nano is not small when it comes to time scale. Let us look at the weight scale, right? Okay. Here I used to ask a lot of questions like when I was basically presenting the talk, but let me still continue. Imagine you are kind of having 18 nanograms of water. 18 nanograms of water. How many molecules of water will be there in 18 nanograms of water? You are all BSc students, most of you, but still this is a very easy question. Why did I ask 18? Why should not I ask 10, 15? A particular reason that I asked 18 nanograms. 18 is the molecular weight of water. Therefore, if I take 18 grams of water, it will have 6.023, which is one mole. It will have 6.023 into 10 power 23 molecules of water. 18 grams will have 6.023 into 10 power 23. Now, if I have 18 nanograms, so that's 10 power 23 should be multiplied by 10 power minus 9 because I'm having only nanograms, right? So, if I multiply that, even then, the number of water molecules that are present in 18 nanograms, because water's density is 1, 18 nanograms means 18 milliliters, right? Sorry, 18 grams means 18 milliliters of water, right? So even 18 nanograms of water or 18 will have basically 10 power 14 molecules of water. 10 power 14 is not small, right? 10 power 14. One after that, you have to put 14 zeros, right? So many molecules of water. If you take so many molecules of water, the properties of water that are bulk properties of water and the properties of water that have 10 to the power 14 molecules will be exactly the same. You will not see any difference, right? But when we say nanomaterials, we all know that they have different properties. I'll show you some of them later. So, which means that 18, again, nanogram is not a small number, right? So, if you want to really have few water molecules, like 100 water molecules, let us say, you know how many liters of water you need to have? You need to have a jeptoliter of water. If you have a jeptoliter of water, you might have 100 molecules of water, right? So, a jeptoliter, again, is 10 power 12, right? 12 orders of magnitude smaller than a nano, right? A nanogram, right? Or a nanoliter. So, jepto is 10 power 12, another 12 orders of magnitude smaller than nano. So, you see how small, you need to go if you want to really feel that it may be small in the time scale and in the weight scale. But when it comes to length scale, something interesting happens. In length scale, a nanometer is 10 power minus 9 meters, right? What is 10 power minus 10 meters? We are all very familiar with it, right? And especially in chemistry, we call it with a very interesting name, with a name of a person. And then we are always, the teachers keep on asking us that question. So 10 power minus 10 meters is angstrom, right? So all our atoms, molecules, and all other things that we are familiar with are of the size of an angstrom, right? Whatever is available at a natural world is of the size of an angstrom. You may ask me a question, so atoms are angstrom size, but we can also break up atoms, right? But you may be able to break up atoms, but what will you have? You will have subatomic particles, electrons, neutrons. Even if you break them, you might have what are called, some people call them as God particles, quarks, bosons, etc., etc. But these are extremely difficult to even see. And because of their small size, they almost all of them display this wave particle duality. So you will not be able to see the size of them. And obviously, you cannot even handle them. So you, if you want to have this, you know, you can prove their presence, but you can never handle them properly. So the smallest system that you can handle at a length scale is an angstrom scale, right? So smallest system that you can handle, for example, if you take sodium chloride, right, dissolve and dissolve it in water, what it will be having? Sodium ions and chloride ions, right? The sodium ion, the size will be somewhere in some angstroms, right? So you can handle angstrom level even in a kitchen, basically, right? In your kitchen, you can dissolve sodium chloride, and there are some angstrom level units that are swimming around in your water. So angstrom level units you can handle. And above all that, you should be able to handle. Therefore, nano, at least in the length scale, is making you reach a limit, right, of the things that you can handle at a large scale or at a, you know, at a home level or at a personal level. So you can handle these systems, and then once you can handle these systems, you can make many more interesting things out of them, right? This is the reason why, this is the fundamental reason why we are interested in meter, you know, when it comes to nano, but not, we are not interested in gram or second, right? Nanosecond and nanogram are very big as compared to a nanometer, right? So the nanometer objects are extremely, extremely small. In fact, if you have a nanometer object, it might have maybe, you know, 100 atoms, right? You know, 100 atom particle, the size of it will be somewhere around a nanometer, one nanometer. So this is the reason why we are basically reaching the limit of what we can handle. And that is the reason why scientists are so much interested in, you know, dealing with nanometer, right? And that is why this particular statement by famous scientist Eugene Wang is very nice, because it says nanometer is a magical point on the length scale. Again, please remember, it is on the length scale only. So a nano is not a magical point on the weight scale, or not a magical point on the time scale, but it is a magical point on the length scale, because this is a point where the smallest man-made or human-made devices like atoms and molecules meet, like, you know, the natural world. You know, the atoms and molecules are available, and then we can make devices out of it, right? So this is the reason why even, you know, the famous physicist Richard Feynman said there is plenty of the room at the bottom, because if you can arrange the atoms and molecules the way you want, you will be able to see some very interesting properties, okay? And are we the first person to basically, like, you know, make some interesting and important applications out of nanoscale objects? No way, right? And as we all know, Mother Nature has always done, you know, one step ahead of us. And then there are very interesting things that we can see when it comes to nano and Mother Nature, right? And one of the important, you know, always famous example that was being shown by Professor Abdul J. Kalam, our former president and a great scientist, was this peacock. And then he was showing peacock and nanotechnology, and everybody was saying, yeah, peacock and nanotechnology, peacock and nanotechnology. But, you know, what is exactly there in peacock that, you know, that is related to nanoscience and technology, right? So if you want to see a peacock feather, basically, and, you know, you might see that, you know, it almost appears, you know, with these beautiful colors that are displayed here, right? But if you really take out one kind of strand out of feather and then see it, it actually does not display so many colors that is actually it is displaying here, right? So the one strand is not displaying so many colors, but it is, when it is combined, it is displaying all these beautiful colors. What is happening there, right? And in fact, if you want to know, the peacock feather is exactly made up of the same material that, you know, our hair is made up of. The protein is keratin and the dye is melanin, right? There are some other, few other dyes, but more or less, this is the maximum amount of material that is present, keratin and melanin. But still, the peacock is displaying so much, so many beautiful feathers, colored feathers, whereas, you know, we are not able to do it. So what is the difference? So if you see, what scientists have done is, they have taken this peacock feather and then put it under what is called an electron microscope, right, which can give you a very high magnification, but not just high magnification, it can also give you very good resolution. So when some time comes, I will probably explain to you in any later stage what is a resolution, magnification, etc. But for you, what is important to see is the scale bar here. It is somewhere around 500 nanometers, right? So if you cannot see, I am telling you the scale bar is 500 nanometers. So what you see here is that the presence of some globule kind of thing, some kind of spherical objects arranged in a periodic fashion, right? with some gaps. Whatever the, you know, these black gap, things that are, you are seeing in between are the gaps present, are the holes that are present. And whatever the white stuff that you are seeing are basically the protein globules that are present, right? And you can see that they are arranged in a periodic fashion, right? So whenever something is arranged in a periodic fashion, something very interesting happens, and which is basically explained in this cartoon here, right? So this is again a kind of a grid that you can see. And the grid is basically, you can see there are some gaps here and there is some holes here, right? There are holes, and between those holes there is some gap, right? So if this size of the hole and the gap is somewhere around the visible region, so what can happen is you shine white light, and then based on this size and then the gap, so you might be able to, you know, get out one color. And if you change that, right, you know, the size and then the gap, another color might come out, right? So in the peacock feather, these are kind of arranged in a very periodic way, and then when this white light goes in, there will be at some places maybe blue color is coming out, some places the red color is coming out, and there will be some constructive interference, etc., etc., and that leads to these beautiful colors. There is no physical color, right? Like a dye that has been put on the surface. It is only this, you know, light going through that gap and then displaying these beautiful colors, and that is what the peacock now displays, right? That is why, you know, like a peacock goes into a rain and then dances, right? And if you wear a very beautiful color shirt, if you are asked to go out and dance, you will be worried, oh, what happened to my color, my shirt, right? But you cannot go and dance or go and stand in a sun sunny day, right? And then you think, oh, my color will fade away. But here, in the peacock case, it doesn't do that, right? But don't worry about all that. What is more important is that you see this paper, there is a paper that is published explaining all these features that was published somewhere around 2003. So we started realizing these things. Recently, I mean, scientific terms, 18 years is not very far, right? 2021, 2003. It's not very far. So we started realizing all these things very recently. This is another example. I'm not going to spend much time because my colleague who will talk next will be talking about that. So this is basically, again, a lotus leaf, which is known to display what is called super hydrophobicity, right? So water does not stick. Again, what people have realized is that, and I will just show the summary of that, people have realized that this is coming because of the presence of a micro-nano hierarchical structures on the surface of lotus leaf. When you rub your fingers on a lotus leaf, you might be seeing it as very smooth, but it is not very smooth, right? There are these hierarchical protrusions present on the surface of the lotus leaf that impart this super hydrophobicity. As I said, this will be talked about my colleague later. And another interesting thing is, on the same super hydrophobicity, in the case of lotus leaf, as you have seen in this video, you can see that the water is running off on the surface, right? It is basically, if you see the one dropper, a droplet, it will be like a spherical shape, but it will not wet the surface. And if you tilt it, it will run off, right? Now you see, take another example, another natural example, what is called a rose petal, right? In a rose petal also, early morning, I'm sure most of you, when you wake up, you might be seeing these kinds of features. So on a rose petal, again, the water is like a droplet. It is not wetting. It is not making a film. It is remaining like a droplet, but still it is not falling off, right? So lotus leaf is behaving some type, and then rose petal is behaving another way, right? So again, you know, people have realized what happens, and then people try to scientific examples or scientific reasons for the same kind of a behavior. As I said, this will be touched upon in more detail by my colleague, Dr. Matte, later. Okay, some more interesting examples of this nano. Let me see whether this video will play. So you can see, okay, this video is not coming through. What should I do? I think I should share the full screen, is it? Maybe that is better. 1 minute, just give me a 1 minute. Okay. 1 minute, just give me. So there is some sound, but that is missing. Don't worry about that. This is a very popular movie clip from a film. You can see the police has fired a bullet to our hero. And then what happened? The bullet ricocheted back, came back. I will play for you again. Right? Sometimes you might feel all the things look very silly, but like, you know, this can sometimes inspire us to do some important discoveries. See this? He is firing a bullet. The bullet is going. Our hero is not bothered at all. And the bullet is coming back and hitting, right? So it looks definitely silly in the movie clip, but now I will show you what happens in a lab. So you see this, what happened in a lab, okay? There is a bullet fired at a cloth, nylon cloth, and you can see there is a hole that has been formed, right? Again, bullet fired, hole formed. Now this is a nylon cloth, this is also a nylon cloth, but it was infused with, made composite with some silica nanoparticles. Now you see what is happening, right? The bullet is hitting and going back, right? How interesting it will be. You can wear these kinds of shirts and then go to anywhere and then like challenge anyone. Come on, fire at me, right? So this is all what we can do if such nanotechnology based things come out. This is another example. You can see here, this is a very interesting example, and I think this has a lot of relevance to the current things that are happening. You know, in the last 1 year during the pandemic, several hospitals that you might have seen, there were fire accidents, and then people who were in ICU who could not move, unfortunately, died, right? So, and most of these fire accidents, the major reason they spread very fast is the bed sheets, curtains, etc., etc. So here, what has been done in this slide, or what is being shown in this movie, is a cloth that has been again kind of made a composite with some nanoparticles, and you see, without the nanoparticles, the fire was spreading very fast on the cloth, but when you put the nanoparticles in, this fire was not at all spreading, so it was not able to catch fire, right? There is some heat that is absorbing, becoming dark, etc., but it is not catching fire, even when it is kind of directly put with such a high intensity fire like this here, right? So all these things are possible. Right? And why such dramatic behavior? Because all these things have been kind of infused with nanoparticles, right? So, and these nanoparticles are known to change a lot of properties of the materials, like color, conductivity, crystal shape, magnetism, melting points, all those things. So again, some of those things will be touched upon by my colleagues in the later talks, right? I don't want to go to that. Now I will go to some applications of these nanomaterials, and especially these applications related to medicine and drug, right? Nanoscience and technology have many, many applications, but I'm going to touch upon one important topic, that is medicine and drugs, and then tell you how you can make these nanomaterials be useful for these applications. And then for these drug-related applications, especially you need to be good at least they can have some knowledge of chemistry, physics, biology, engineering, all those things. You should be master of many of these things. Right? Now only when then you will be able to do these things. Again, there is some video. Ramakrishna, can you mute that? I'll try to play this video here. Because I need the... Shall I mute now? Shall I play?
Speak up in the back there.
Are you able to listen to the audio?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is not done by us, the video was done by.
Hello, sir.
1 minute. So what has been shown actually in that video was that there were cells and normal cells and cancerous cells, and these nanoparticles which were kind of decorated with the two types of surfaces. One is basically what is called a protective layer, and there were obviously drugs inside, and there was a protective layer, and there was a targeting moiety. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. So, so what has been shown is that they have prepared some of these nanoparticles, and these nanoparticles were decorated. First of all, there were some drugs inside these nanoparticles, and there was a protective layer, and there were this targeting moiety which enabled these nanoparticles to selectively go and target the cancer cells and infuse with them and deliver the drug inside. So it was like a courier boy. You give an address to the courier boy, and the courier boy gives the cargo to only to that address that is basically given on the surface, basically, right? So this is the targeting address, and this is basically protecting the nanoparticle. I'll tell you why the protection is needed. And this is the cargo. The drug is the cargo, right? So this is what a nanoparticle based drug delivery all about, right? So how do you prepare the nanoparticles? There are two ways of preparing the nanoparticles. What is called a top-down approach and then the bottom-up approach. In the top-down approach, you whatever material you want to make it as a nanoparticle, you take it and then start grinding it. Like, the perfect example is the Ellora, the temples which were Mahabalipuram temples, which were basically carved out of a big single stone. You remove whatever is unnecessary and keep whatever is necessary. There is one way of making material. The other way of making material, but in that, lot of material goes waste because you're removing it, right? But whereas in the bottom-up approach, what you do is basically you assemble the materials one by one. And as I told you, these atoms and ions are smaller than nanoparticles. I told you, right? The atom size is angstroms, whereas nanoparticles are nanometer size, right? One order of magnitude at least larger. So if you can assemble these atoms and molecules together, and then first they will become clusters, and these clusters can grow and then become nanoparticles. So this is called bottom-up approach. You take the atoms and then make clusters, and from that you make nanoscale materials or nanoparticles. So in chemistry lab, this is generally the procedure that we follow, the bottom-up approaches, right? So again, there is no audio here, but I hope the video plays. Just give me back. So you can see the video where my student is preparing the gold nanoparticles. So he takes some precursors, that is basically gold salt, which is containing gold ions. That, as I said, gold ions, gold atoms are smaller than nanoparticles. So he took something that is containing gold ions, made some solution, and to that he adds what is called a reducing agent. Why reducing agent? Because in the salt form, the gold ions are, for example, if you take sodium chloride, the sodium ions are in the Na plus form. So Na plus is basically an oxidized form. So it is not having the requisite number of electrons. When something is oxidized, you are taking away electrons. So you need to reduce it to make it into metal. So what we do is we take any precursor of a nanoparticle, which is basically like a metal salt, which is in the metal is in the oxidized form, and you add electrons to that. The reaction is called reduction, and you make these metal atoms. And these metal atoms come together, as I showed in the previous slide, make a cluster, and these clusters come together, make a nanoparticle. Right? This is how we in the lab we make these nanoparticles. Okay, so yeah, it is there. Okay. So as I said, we need to make nanoparticles to be useful for a medical application, right? Okay. So we have made nanoparticles now. Can we use them? The problem with such nanoparticles, which you have right now made, which are of course in the water medium, is that they are not very stable, right? So if you take a nanoparticle made out of that and then look at what is again called a transmission and electron microscope image, they will look something like this. You will see some kind of a discs like this, right? These discs are nothing but a two-dimensional projection of a spherical object, right? That's what you see. And you will see that these nanoparticles are nicely in a dispersed state in a given solvent. Means there are particles, but you see them as if they are a solution, right? So they are dispersed particles in a solvent. And why are the particles are so stable in the solvent? Because there is a charged double layer. This is like, I don't know, you must have seen milk, right? Milk is a colloidal dispersion of protein. Likewise, blood is a colloidal dispersion of our hemoglobin, etc. So these are colloidal dispersions where there is a charge present on the surface. Likewise, even in this case of gold nanoparticles, there is a charge present on the surface. And this charge prevents the nanoparticles from coming together and aggregating, right? But unfortunately, this charge stabilization is not good enough for any application. You can make nanoparticles, but they are not good enough for any application. So though nanoparticles have been synthesized, you cannot try them for drug delivery, because anything that you want to try on them, these nanoparticles undergo what is called an irreversible aggregation. Irreversible aggregation. This is not a reversible aggregation. They are irreversible aggregation. Again, a great example of an irreversible aggregation is that you can make cheese and paneer out of milk, right? So you break milk and then you curdle milk and then you make cheese and paneer. But can you make milk out of cheese and paneer? By again dispersing back those proteins back into water, you cannot do that, because that's an irreversible process, right? Likewise, here also, though we have made nanoparticles, because of whatever we wanted to do, it will cause an irreversible aggregation. You will not be able to use these nanoparticles for any application. So to again give you an analogy, So these nanoparticles are almost like a newborn baby. And when a baby is born just, you know, a few minutes ago, a few seconds ago, what will we do? Do we go out and then display the baby to all of our friends and the family saying that, oh, here Bahubali has come? You immediately wrap the baby in a protective kind of an environment, say that, okay, like now this is baby new, this baby might be susceptible to environmental or viral or bacterial infections, so let us protect, right? So likewise, when the nanoparticles were immediately made, as I said, you know, they are like, you know, like this, basically. There is, you know, this only metal surface that is present with some kind of a charges on the surface. But this protection alone is not good enough to stabilize this nanoparticle as a dispersion. So what the scientists have realized is that if you can put a protective coat like you have put for a newborn baby, maybe these nanoparticles will be stable in a solvent. And that protective coat is nothing but an organic molecule. I'm sure you must have heard about molecules such as long alkyl chains, like amines, carboxylic acids, thiols, phosphines, etc. So what these molecules will have is one functional group. This functional group can be a thiol group, it could be a carboxylic acid group, it could be an amine group, whatever it is. And then attached to that, you will have a CH2, like that. Like, so typically 10 or 12 carbon atoms will be there. So such a long alkyl chain attached with a functional group is a nice protective layer on the surface of these nanoparticles. Okay, and with such protection, you will be able to really put lot of, you can really stabilize lot of these nanoparticles in a solvent, right? There is no irreversible aggregation anymore. So this was first done in 1994 by a person called Matthias Press. And what they could show is that once you make these nanoparticles, you could actually precipitate them and redisperse them. Precipitate them and redisperse them whenever you wanted, because there is now a protective layer. In the previous case, when there was only charges present on the surface, these nanoparticles were irreversibly aggregating. But now this is a reversible aggregation. You can precipitate them and redisperse them whenever you want. This was a very useful way of making nanoparticles. So now, what I said, we have to make nanoparticles for drug delivery. We made nanoparticles using water as a solvent, but this protective layer makes them hydrophobic. I don't know what happened. I moved it, but so this protective layer is actually makes these nanoparticles hydrophobic, right? So that's why again these nanoparticles are not useful for drug delivery, because for drug delivery these nanoparticles have to be put in water, not in any non-polar organic solvents. Right now, these nanoparticles can be put only non-polar solvents like toluene, benzene, hexane, etc. But we don't take any drug with toluene, benzene, no? We have to take it in water, right? So again, like an analogy, you may put any good dress, but if you don't know how to kind of, you know, for the season that is suitable dress, it will be very, you know, it looks very funny, right? And I don't know what this guy is doing wearing this kind of a dress and then, you know, jumping into ice. I don't know what happened to him after that, right? This guy has put very nice dress up, absolutely fantastic, but they forgot to take an umbrella. Right? And again, what happened to him, we don't know, right? So you need to have a suitable dress for a suitable application. Likewise, we made stable nanoparticles, but they are now hydrophobic. So you need to make suitable nanoparticles, right? So how to make suitable nanoparticles? Here, now people have realized that if you want to make these nanoparticles suitable for drug delivery applications, the problem is that the end group, right? So this, there is a long chain alkane molecules. I'm sure all of you know when we draw this structure like this, it means that there is a CH2 like that. And the end group is CH3, methyl group. These are methylene groups and these are methyl groups, right? So this methyl-methylene group combination makes these nanoparticles hydrophobic in nature, because these molecules are themselves are hydrophobic in nature, right? So what we need to do is basically modify the exterior surface of the nanoparticle and make them hydrophilic. right? And for that, we can make many strategies. And one of that strategy I will show you in the next slide, because I am running out of time. So you can see that this is the original way of making nanoparticles using a functional group that can be carboxylic acid, thiol, amine, whatever, and these alkyl chains where this N group is CH3. But if you can modify this N group alone and make it like a sugar, right? So then this N group is hydrophilic in nature, and therefore these nanoparticles could be dispersed in water, right? And many strategies have been made to make nanoparticles like this. And then in fact, our group also did some work, and I'll show that right away. So what our group did is, we actually started using a molecule called sulfurolipid. Sulfurolipid is nothing but a modification of a famous molecule called oleic acid. Oleic acid, you can see, it has a functional group carboxylic acid here at one end, and it has a CH3, CH2, CH2 kind of a group at another end, right? But if you make oleic acid, treat with oleic acid with some yeast, which is basically a species called Candida vomicola, what you can do is you can put two sugar moieties at the other end. So this molecule is now, oleic acid is not soluble in water, but this molecule is soluble in water. And not only that, when it anchors to a nanoparticle surface, it anchors through the carboxylic acid moiety, exposing the sugar to the solvent. Therefore, these oleic acid molecules are kind of dispersible in water. So we have made now, basically, like, you know, these are some silver nanoparticles made in the laboratory using oleic acid. And you can see that these nanoparticles, the bottles you are seeing in the inset is basically as prepared, what we call as prepared nanoparticles. And the two is nothing but you make a powder of these nanoparticles and then add water again, right? So, and then they go back into the dispersive state. As I was telling you, in the other case, these were basically irreversible aggregation in the charged cellular state. But in this case, when there is a monolayer of organic molecules, these are redispersible in water whenever you want. So this is one good thing. So we made some, you know, basically, you know, with some protection that is making these nanoparticles stable in water or dispersible in water. Can we go for a drug delivery? So for that, we need to basically put some drug on the surface of this nanoparticle, right? So that is the next step that we need to do, right? So how do we put this drug on the surface of the nanoparticles? Again, I will take some analogy. This is like now making some functional dresses, right? So for each application, you need a different kind of a dress. So somebody is getting married, they will dress like this. Somebody is going to for a war, they will dress like this. And somebody is mountaineering, going for a mountaineering, they will dress like this, right? So we need to now make these nanoparticles functional, right? And for that, you know, there are many, many strategies. One of the strategies that basically, like, you know, people use is to have, for example, a core of nanoparticle and have functional molecules that can now, for example, target and then go to a particular location. As I told you, one is having a protection layer. So some of them are protective layers here, and some others are basically targeting layers. So whatever you are seeing here as like a Y is like an antibody. It can take these nanoparticles to a specific location. And this example being shown is basically iron oxide nanoparticles. And these iron oxide nanoparticles, when they are injected, so you know, like, you know, you must have heard this word MRI, then people going for MRI scan whenever there is a problem, right? So MRI scan uses very strong magnetic materials like gadolinium salts. So there are some issues with gadolinium salts, including, like, you know, you are using a metal like gadolinium. So can we use a more benign material like iron oxide? So iron oxide is also strongly magnetic, but earlier it was very difficult to stabilize it in very, very small, whereas we could have gadolinium salts with very strong magnetic characteristics, but iron was not having so much strong magnetic characteristics. But now what people do is make iron oxide nanoparticles, because they are nanoparticles, there are many iron ions present in that, and these so many iron ions give stronger magnetic characteristics. So you can make these iron oxide nanoparticles, you can use them for MRI scanning instead of gadolinium salts. But not only that, another interesting thing is that if you apply magnetic field, what is called an AC magnetic field, you can also, because you have now targeted these magnetic particles to a particular location, to a cell, cancer cell, so you can also apply magnetic field, heat them whenever you want, like the way you want, and cause a local heat. right? And this is called hyperthermia. So when you cause this hyperthermia, this cancer cells. Kavikala, I think that you need to, yeah. So these cancerous cells get, killed. So not only you made a nanoparticle which is functional, which is targeting, it also can be used for therapeutic applications. And such applications are called theranostic applications, right? You are able to diagnose the diagnostics and you can also do therapeutics. So these are called theranostic applications. So, we have done one layer of functionalization. You might need to do double layer of functionalization. Again, for example, here you can see these people. I don't know why they are wanting to do it, but anyway, what they are trying to do is they are trying to get exchange rings while jumping, right? So obviously they can do that. Unfortunately, poor fellow, this fellow who is actually holding a Bible, he's also jumping there, jumping along with them, right? So, but functional nanoparticles if you want to target multiple things like theranostic kind of an application. So in the next view graph, what I show, again, if I think it is a little slow, So in the next view graph, what we show is again, gold nanoparticles capped by a molecule called gallant gum. So this gallant gum has, four carbohydrate units. It's a repeat units of four carbohydrate units, and one of them is called glucuronic acid and glucose. It has both glucose and glucuronic acid. And because of the glucuronic acid, it will have negative charges. And then because of the glucose, what happens is, what we hypothesize is that this can cross what is called blood-brain barrier. So we made gold nanoparticles capped by this gallant gum and then put a drug molecule. So like I told you, right? They have put wedding gown and on top of that parachute. Here, there is a the gallant gum is there, and on top of that, we are putting an anti-cancer drug called doxorubicin. So once we put this multifunctional system, and then when we tested it in, cancer related to the brain tumors, so we could test that these nanoparticles could enter into those cells and then bring out anti-cancer activity. So this is how you could bring multifunctionality. And the presence of this glucose, because this blood-brain barrier is known to block everything else, but is known to allow glucose. So we thought, because of the presence of the glucose, these nanoparticles also can enter into these brain tumor cell lines. This LN18 and LN229 are the brain tumor cell lines. So this is another example that we have found. As a final example, I'm coming to an end, I took a little more time. So you can also sometimes make the system full, right? So here, as an example, I'm showing you two photographs. I hope all of you recognize, right? And so this is a beggar and this is a rich man, right? That is what you could actually figure out from this figure. But if I now show who is this person, this is nothing but both the persons present in this photograph are the same. Is none other than this singer Sonu Nigam. Sonu Nigam did an experiment where he sat on a pavement, disguised like a beggar. And then when he did that, nobody even cared when he was singing. Sonu Nigam was singing on a pavement, but like a beggar, but nobody cared. But the same Sonu Nigam, the same evening, he was giving a concert in an open auditorium. And the tickets were 1,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees, 5,000 rupees, whatever you can imagine. And people were paying tickets to basically listen to them. Here, in one case, Sonu Nigam as a beggar was begging. Nobody cared. In the other case, Sonu Nigam was, he said, I am Sonu Nigam. And therefore, please come and listen to my songs. And then he did it. So, that's how you can actually, disguise and then fool people, right? So, here, what we try to do in one of the experiments, we try to make nanoparticles capped with a molecule called bovine serum albumin. Again, all the details are in the previous slide. I did not spend much time. Don't worry about that. What we made is nanoparticles capped by a molecule called bovine serum albumin. These albumins are proteins which are required for energy, especially for cell cleavage and cell duplication, cell passage or cell duplication, basically like when they become more and more cells, this energy is required. And obviously cancer cells are growing much faster as compared to the normal cells. And therefore, what we thought is, when something is growing very fast, it needs more food. And because serum albumins are like food for the cells, what we thought is, if we put these nanoparticles with bovine serum albumin, the cancer cells will preferentially take up the bovine serum albumin cap particles, and therefore also could be delivered into them. So you can see that the top panel is showing non-cancerous cell lines. These are fibroblast cell lines, NH3, and the bottom line, as I showed, is basically the brain tumor cell lines. And as you can see, these nanoparticles, which are actually not loaded with any drug, but actually loaded with a dye, just to show you the phenomenon, you can see that here you don't see any nanoparticles on the surface of the cell. Whereas here, you see a lot of nanoparticles. This is basically the nucleus of the cell. So you can see that by doing this, we could say that, you know, the cancer cells to make, to take more of the nanoparticle as compared to the normal cell lines, right? So this is another example of, you know, how you can do that. And now I have shown some examples of what all you can do. Putting a dye, putting a drug, putting, you know, surface coating, etc. But what is beautiful about nanoparticles is, you can do all of them in one go. You can put molecules that are like antibodies that are specific targeting. You can put molecules like bovine serum albumin that will allow preferential uptake of these nanoparticles. You can put some fluorescent labeling like dyes that we have put in the previous slide. Or we can put all of them together, including some drug molecules like doxorubicin that we have done, and make a multifunctional nanoparticle. On the surface of one nanoparticle, you could put the address, you could put the drug, you could put the preferential uptake, you could put fluorescent tagging so that you can actually track whether the nanoparticle is going to the respective address that you have given. So all that can be done in one go. So this is the beauty of this nanoparticle. So what I could show is that, you know, we can take some raw materials, convert them into kind of, you know, beautiful decorated nanoparticles. Of course, you know, here on the left side, you are not seeing any decorated nanoparticles, but you are seeing some decorated people. But here on the left hand side, you can see, on the right hand side, you can see taking some precursors of metals and using some organic molecules, we could make these kind of, you know, decorated nanoparticles. And these decorated nanoparticles can be used for interesting applications. So in final slide, I would say nanoscience. Of course, this is not nanoscience. Of course, this is basically the dresses that you can see. All kinds of names are there. I don't know. Many of them, Capri's, 3-4s, whatnot. I don't know. Many of them. But anyway, so this definitely looks beautiful, creative. But when it comes to nanoscience, it is not only creative. Of course, to us, it is beautiful. But it is more importantly, very useful. Thank you very much. I have taken, about 15 minutes probably. But I will be happy to take any questions if you have.
Anybody have any clarifications? You can please unmute yourself. I think there is a issue of unmuting themselves, sir. You can even put in the chat box. Who have some clarifications can put in the chat box.
Chat box, and then, like, somebody can read them. That is much more better than.
Yes.
Correct.
And somebody can read it for us, and then.
When that is going on, sir, I must really thank you for the one of the most interesting lectures that I have heard in my life, sir. Oh, if I can dare to say this, had you chosen teaching profession, you would have been an excellent teacher, sir, so effective and popular. You started from the beginning and ended at the top of the mountain. Extremely impressive presentation, sir. Thank you so much. for this presentation.
These presentations would make much more, effective when we do it in offline.
That is so true. We are all yearning to meet each other in person and exchange these ideas in person. I hope God will really, help us to do that very soon, sir.
Hopefully, like by the end of this year, we'll be able to do that. Yeah.
Many people are saying that it was wonderful lecture, sir. they're sending the messages.
Thank you.
Very informative. See, one by one, I'm getting all these people saying that extremely informative and very interesting. And I think some people will post in their questions also, sir. As soon as they post, I will definitely disturb you, sir, and trouble you and ask you for the answers. And we will get back to the students for the answers.
Yeah.
Now, before that, I want to call upon Mr. Joshua Davale, a stakeholder, semester four student, sir. He would formally tell you how impressed the student community and the teacher community, the participants in general, are today.
Sure.
So can I request Joshua to take over?
Yes, ma'am. A warm and graceful morning to our most valued speaker, Professor B.L.V. Prasad, sir, the principal, Dr. L.D. Horakeri, sir, the management committee of B.C. Jabin Science College, worthy teachers and everyone gathered here. I, Joshua, a student of PC Jabin Science College, am privileged to propose the vote of thanks. On behalf of our college and the entire fraternity of the Department of Chemistry, I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to the Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, Bengaluru, for organizing this seminar. Today, we had the opportunity of hearing from Professor B.L.V. Prasad, sir, on nanoparticle synthesis, surface modifications, and applications. Your words have enlightened and sparked a curiosity in us and will surely encourage us in our future prospects in nanoparticle study and science as a whole. My heartfelt gratitude to sir for sharing his invaluable knowledge with us and for setting aside your time from your busy schedule. We are very grateful, sir. Thank you very much. A special mention to our respectful principal, Dr. L.D. Horakeri, sir, for supporting and encouraging learning arrangements such as these. I would also like to thank the people who work behind the scenes, including our proactive and dedicated staff. Last but certainly not least, I thank all the participants for your active involvement in today's session. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. Actually, I'm very intrigued by the titles of your lectures also, sir. So interesting to catch the attention, students' attention, to learn about your branch of science. Thank you once again, sir. I think how many ever words we use, they will not do justice to what we are actually feeling. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay, I think we should go to the next one. Yes, sir. Thank you.
With our program, our next speaker is Dr. HSS Ramakrishna Mate Garu. He is a scientist in Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, Bangalore. He has kindly agreed to speak on another extremely important title, Nanoscience, the New and Big Science of Small. Such interest. Sometimes I wish if we were born some 30-40 years later, we would have been exposed to such beautiful aspects of science, which we missed when we were the age of the students who have gathered here. Children, I should tell you that you people are extremely fortunate, not only to learn so much, but from such great people. So I wish that you people pay complete attention to what is going on around in this seminar, make notes and approach. Everybody is only ready to help you. All you have to do is, gather yourself up, concentrate, focus, and go to the people. They are ready to help you. So I now request Dr. Kujagali Garu, Dr. S.B. Kujagali Garu, to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Ramakrishna Mate Garu. Over to Dr. Kujagali.
Good morning to everyone. I am Dr. S.B. Kausalagi, Associate Professor of Chemistry. I take this opportunity to introduce today's resource person for this online seminar. I am excited at this moment to introduce Dr. HSSR Matte. HSS Ramakrishna Matte, currently working as Scientist D at Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, Bangalore. Sir obtained his BSc degree from Government College, Rajahmundry in 2006 in Andhra Pradesh. And he did his master's degree in 2009 and completed his PhD in 2013 under the guidance of Professor C.N. Rao, FRS, from the Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Science Research, working on various aspects of nanomaterials. Sir did his postdoc at Northwestern University, USA, from 2013 to 2015, under the guidance of Professor Mark Hersham and Professor Tobin J. Marks in the area of organic solar cells. Later, he moved to Professor Norbert Koch Group at Humboldt University in Berlin to work on doping of organic semiconductors. Sir is currently working research interests are printed electronics, low dimensional materials, electrochemical sensors, batteries, and organic photovoltaics. Dr. Matte has published more than 50 research articles in reputed international peer-reviewed journals with 6,900 citations with H index 28. Sir got 3 patents to his credit. His group is actively involved in collaborating with various multinational companies looking for the possibilities of commercializing nanotechnology-based products from lab to land. Here I present Dr. HSS Ramakrishna Matte, sir, to this seminar. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope I am audible.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes,
quite
sir.
Clear, sir.
Okay. So it's again my honor and privilege to be part of an event like this. And I really thank all the people, particularly the RSC and the SENS, for giving me this opportunity to interact with all of you guys. So what I'll do is I'll share the screen, and please let me know if there are any issues. I hope you're able to see my screen.
We are able to see it, sir.
Awesome. So, as I said, I'll be thanking KLE Society, PCJM College, Hubli, and then RSC UK Deccan Section, and again, our own people at SENS for giving me this opportunity to interact with you. And as I said, we are now also celebrating 75 years of independence, where it is named as an Akam celebration, Azadika Amrut Mahotsav. So it will be considered even part of it. So it is always a good idea to know what are the good things happened around us in the last 75 years and what we need to do down the line. So from a scientific perspective, even otherwise. It's always difficult to talk after our director speaking about introducing the nanoscience. I'll try to do it in a slightly different way than what it is, but essentially he covered most of the aspects on talking about nano. So the reason why when we talk about nano, we try to bring the same thing again and again is it might sound it like boring to start with, but if you recall your childhood days, if not recall, if you can see what is happening, whether your kids are in your home or in your neighborhood, they'll be going to the school and writing the A same so many times till they get feel for A and B, and that's how we learn alphabets. In a similar way, we always believe that nanoscience is not something that you will be taught in your class every day, but it is something which is kind of an upcoming, as you would have understood. So we try to give the same thing with the different flavors and try to get you see whether you really understand nano. For us, here we don't really worry about if somebody asks you about the definition or anything.
But more than that, if you have a feel for what you are hearing is more than sufficient, then you can express in your own language, not necessarily the one which is termed by either IUPAC or the stalwarts in the group. So our interest is to make it clear, how do you feel for nano? So to some extent, director has also given his shades of showing it, and probably I'll be doing it with these things. I'll be restricting myself in recollecting some of the very fundamentals of nano, and again, putting it in a perspective where we can feel them, and try to give some examples where self-feeling has been taught and extend, but I'll try to bring some kind of an additional information on how to see that. And what are the learnings from the Gigo scrolling on the wall and the drug delivery I won't touch because he has already spent enough time on these aspects. So here what I will be doing is the things essentially you don't have to do anything special for nano other than learning lessons from nature. If you are curious enough, if you are interested enough to learn things from nature, and if we can imitate that, I think then we are more or less successful in making our life better, because if you know really how nature works and if you try to imitate and make them in an industrial way so that things which are not available during particularly if you are talking about the electricity or anything, so if we can make up our own, sun is not around, we can start using them in the night time. That's the reason we have started effectively utilizing the 24 hours of what we have. In a similar way, every time the scientific advancement will help you to utilize your resources in a better way and take you to decisions which are logical and makes some impact in a way that you will carry or doing your daily routines. So as I said, I'm not so much interested in giving you the definition that what you typically get in textbooks, because that is the case, you don't really have to listen here. You can just buy a textbook and get it. Right? So, if you go and read any nanoscience definition, it says about the objects, phenomena, which happens in the scale of nanometer. So this is what exactly what you will read. But if you want to really feel for it, then probably you may have to put a bit of effort. And then if you can understand this scale, scale is something which, forget about nano behind, as a prefix of it. Scale is something which we often use in our life, whether to measure something or to quantify something or to express something. Because if you say, I'm a big paper, it doesn't make any sense. What is that big? Unless until you bring in some units, that's what where the scale is coming up into picture. In a similar way, what exactly is the nanoscale? So for that reason, for today, let us restrict ourselves in understanding the units of different objects that we use around, what we see around, from a nano perspective. So for example, what we call them as a macro objects, if you take a person, if the person is around the height of 1 centimeters or 6 feet approximately, that's the conventional way of describing the height. But for today, let us restrict ourselves to call them or to express them in nano units, what we call them as 2 billion nanometers. You know how big a number of billion is. Because the reason why I wanted to bring is, I can easily imagine a person of 6 feet high without much thinking, okay, he could be of this height or he could be of like this. But because we got used to the units called feet or centimeters. But nano is not something new, not only for you, even for us. So how do we see that we are getting used to it? So that's how let us try to express everything what we know or what we think about or what we see around in nanometer, and let's see how that would help us in imagining how big is a nano or how small is nano. That is actually big and small are relative words, and I don't really want to talk about them because it's all about the relative frame that you're looking at. So now the 6 feet person is becoming like a 2 billion nanometer guy. And now let's take another example of an apple with a diameter of around 8 centimeters.
And if I express again in the nanometer units, it will become 80 million nanometers. So something which we all aware and which we try to see it as a smaller object or a smaller insect kind of thing, which is ant, and let us assume you are having a wild ant, which is 5 centimeters, you're talking, I mean, which is not really small. If you see it from the length scales of nanometer, it is 5 million nanometer. So ant is not as small as what we usually think about. And now, coming to the human hair, the diameter of a single strand is around 80,000 nanometers. And the things that what we can see, of course, there are some discrepancies around the how much we can see. There are different ways of looking into it. But on an approximate scale, let us assume that the smallest thing or what is conventionally agreed upon in the literature is the smallest thing that which we can see with our human eye is around 10,000 nanometers. There's a clear-cut correlation with the next example, which I'm going to take, is bacteria. See, it means that anything smaller than 10,000 nanometers, your eyes cannot see it. That's the reason we won't see bacteria, because typically the bacteria size is around 2,000 nanometers. That's what, if you can recollect some of the advertisements that you see, be it with Colgate or Lifebuoy or whoever it is, whenever they're bringing the germs, they try to bring a lens to show that it is a zoomed version to really see the, I mean, they try to bring the lens to show the bacteria. So that's because one simple reason, that's the reason you cannot see them, because of the size, you cannot see a bacteria or viruses. And there is also one correlation which you will be understanding down the line. I've taken one more example of cellulose nanofibrils, which is having a diameter of around 3.5 to 100 nanometers. Probably in the next slide, you'll understand why I've taken this example. And coming to further down, which is essentially nano, the DNA, which is a basic constituent of any evolutionary process, where we have a lot of information coded in that, where the information will be carried to the generations coming in, which is DNA, which is around 2 nanometers. And finally, I wanted to end with hydrogen atom, because when you are in BSc by now, you might have heard a lot about hydrogen atoms and the periodic table. If you take an atom, you're talking about 0.1 nanometers. Now, when we are talking about 1 nanometers to 10 nanometers kind of a thing, we are talking about tens and hundreds of atoms coming up together for doing something for you, which is nothing but nanoscience. So now, don't think so much. I mean, the conclusion or outlook of this slide is nano is not either small or a big. You need to look into a perspective in which you are seeing this. And at the same time, nano means you are playing around with atoms. You, as a kid, would have played with toys, but the moment you become a nanoscientist or an nano engineer, you'll be playing around with atoms. So because we try to work with nanosystems which is less than 100 nanometers, and at best we are talking about 1,000 to 10,000 of atoms. So you know how difficult, you know, it is very difficult to control the students in the classroom. And how do you think will be easy to control these atoms to assemble in a way and listen to you? This is what exactly what we do in terms of achieving or looking at the property that we wanted to see. So controlling these things, because when you make an atom, this will be highly reactive, and they want it to be, and they don't want to be an isolated system. They want to merge with some other atoms and form a bulk system. But if that happens, you will not be utilizing the aspects that are coming at nanoscale. Our interest, or most of the people who are working in the area of nano, is all about controlling the assembly or the formation of these atoms with another atom and try to see whether this will be of any use to us. And of course, at the end of the day, we need to learn the lessons from the nature and try to imitate it in a best possible way, so that whether we can have a better living standards, because the end of the ideal end of doing good science is to see that you are doing good for the human mankind. So that's the final delivery that one would expect from the science and from the scientists. So is it really making sense? Is it an extra burden? So let us try to understand why one needs to learn or read about nano, because what are the other aspects that comes because of exclusively to nano, or the dimensions being in nano, we will be trying to learn things. So to make things clear, if I take an office paper or an A4 sheet, which you are seeing as the far left-hand side, either you take a picture with an DSLR camera, where most of you might be familiar with, this is how it looks like, which is in the left bottom, left and the bottom and the left part of it. So, I mean, you will not be surprised about how good this paper is or whatever, because this you are already seeing with your human eyes, right? And for buying a camera like this, you might be spending around 40,000-50,000 with a resolution of around 0.5mm kind of a thing. But what we are interested is to see the objects which are smaller in nature. So now my job is very, very simple. Let me take the same office paper and place it under different microscopes which are available with us, and then see whether did I get any additional information that I can get which is not available, or which we won't understand if I see with my human eye or with a human eye. So this is the second one. What I do is something called optical microscope, which you might have obviously seen in many labs, and even in your own labs, or if you go for any other labs nearby, like for blood test and other things, this is one of those common things that you keep seeing them, or you keep using it in your daily life. So if I take the same office paper and I put under this microscope, all of a sudden I'm trying to see something which which I was not able to see with my naked eye. So now I started seeing some kind of a dispersions kind of a system, where I've seen colors, different sizes, and even something, you know, like some of the bad roads we have in our places, where you have these cracks and other things. But otherwise, I didn't know that there are cracks on the paper. But what I really wanted to convey you is, these are the things which helps you to write when you're using a pen. I don't know whether you have experienced this or not. You take some pen and you start using it on some other soft papers. Sometimes you may not be in a position to use some of the pens for some kind of a papers because the roughness won't match, and because of that, the ink won't come in. So in a similar way, even with a pencil, it won't be easy to write, right? Because it's because of the interaction between the nip of the pen and the surface of the paper essentially helps you out to write what you are writing. But if I take the same paper and I put under something called a scanning electron microscope, which is obviously expensive, but it has got a much, much higher resolution, which is within the scale that I'm looking at. Yeah, So you started seeing something even more interesting. You see this some kind of a fiber structures which are coming up, which we never knew that these are on the paper. It's just because I understood them by seeing them with my microscope, and I'm because of having a better resolution, I'm able to see some features which are otherwise not able to see with a regular or a naked eye. So now, what I need to do is, what is so great about seeing them in microscope? Anybody can see anything and then find what is next, how I can use them. So if you understand it's a very simple thing. If I ask you to go to a building which is very new to you, which you have never been, and ask you to pick something from one of the rooms in one of the floor, it takes some time for you to go and bring things from there. But if you already have a floor map and the building map, you can easily go there in no time. That's how our Google Maps is helping us, right? In a similar way, if you really know the architecture and if you really wanted to imitate, then probably these structures would help us to imitate them. Of course, we are not so keen as of now to imitate the paper that what you're seeing, but the understanding what we're getting from the paper could be translated to anything else, and that's what you're going to see in the upcoming slides. So now, just to give you the feel, I won't do much about it. What I do is, I'll try to pick some objects which are around, and of course, I wanted to make it clear, most of the resources what I've used a lot from the literature, and we thank all the people who have shared their knowledge and these things in Google.
So this is so that we just correlated them in a way that which makes sense to you. Yeah. So now what my job is to take different objects and put them under the microscope and see how they look like. More than that, what they offer for us because of the structure that they are having. So with that in mind, this is some example where our director has already discussed with you. If it is in a regular class, I would have discussed with you in person kind of thing, what you are thinking about or whatever. This is how a peacock wing looks like. And now, whatever the colors that what he has discussed in detail is all coming because of this photonic structures and the absorption, the color which is coming because of the gap that is in regular assembly of these things. So they have these petals which are assembled in one periodic fashion, giving you the photonic structures and making them visible. I exhibit the colors what they're exhibiting. That's what even given a nice example that peacock won't bother about dancing in rhyme because it knows that the color is not coming from a dye, but it is coming from the structures, which that's what we call them as a structural color. It means you can make any color the way you want without using a dye. That's the take-home message that one would like to have. So coming to the next example, this is how a human eye would look, sorry, an ant's eye would look like. And then other one is, again, I'm repeating one of those examples that I've taken previously. Again, if it is on a one-to-one session or an in-person session, I would have asked you to recollect what I've shown in my previous slide. I would have felt happy if one of you has answered this as a human head. It's kind of repeating and cross-checking with you whether you're following me or not. And this is an image of an human tooth. This is an pollen grain. And you have a four-cell embryo. So the reason why I've taken these examples are something which we see from naked eye, and they won't look like that, particularly human tooth. But if you put under microscope, you're getting a different information. And particularly if you want to make an artificial thing, for sure you need to imitate something like that. Otherwise, you may not be in a position to get the functionality of a naturally grown tooth or teeth, for that matter. So now, partially my job has become simple because director has already discussed to some extent on the hydrophilicity and hydrophobicity. As I said, my interest is to match to what is the title that has been given to the workshop, Nano and Sort for Societal Needs. Like, really, has this been changed the way we are living? If you see some products which are based on nano and you are buying it from the market and you are able to enjoy the features or additional features coming from the nano aspect of it, then obviously you will appreciate it. So one of those things is something what you call an easy wash, where you know in the earlier days, if you play Holi in your home and then your wall is filled of those Holi colors, then you know how your mother would treat you. But nowadays, you may not have to worry to that extent because there are paints where you can call them as spot-free. You can easily wash them away. And particularly, this is another thing, if you are in metropolitan cities, most often you see buildings which are mostly with the glass windows. And rain is something which is common because whenever it rains, you always end up with water falling on your windows and it obstacles the way you're seeing the nature. And it is very critical if you wanted to have a good day because you wanted to see what is happening around. So, but water droplets on the glass surface, as you can see on the left-hand side, will never give you the clarity or the view that you would like to have. But if you're having a 100-story building and you wanted to clean this glass every day, it's not humanly possible because not only from the safety perspective, you need to spend enough amount of man hours to get it clean. Rather than that, if you can get a glass which cleans itself, making your life simple, right? So how do we make a glass which is self-cleaning and you don't have to appoint anyone to clean your glass? Of course, for cars you have, you can do it using the corresponding accessories that you have with that, but that asset you don't have for buildings. So
something like that, particularly kids, when you are in less than, I mean, SSC or 10th standard, this is one of those complaints that you will obviously hear from your parents, that you are spoiling your clothes, shoes, and I'm not able to wash, right? I mean, your mother would always complain, or whoever it is. It could be my father, whoever is washing, or whoever is helping you. So, but if you can get a shoes, or if you can purchase shoes, it doesn't matter what you do or where to play, it still remains to be as clean as after playing, then it's obviously bringing some changes the way you're going to lead your life. And these are not something which are going to happen after 30, 40 years. These are the things which are already available in market. So, yeah. So if you can make these things, I mean, if you're already making these things, how we are able to make these things is all because the hydrophobicity. So probably I'll just play one video just to give you the feel that what are the multiple applications that one could end up with using this kind of coating, where you'll have a variety of applications possible to make your life very simple.
ಕ್ಲಾಸ್ ನಂದ ಇಲ್ಲ ತಗೋ
So this is how the application that you can end up with. Now let us try to understand some definitions, and my interest is here to learn something, to understand the definition in its own perspective, rather than something to by heart or to remember things. So here I'll just try to show you an example on how one would remember things, or one should read things. This is how we would like you to think when you are reading your textbooks or any of the concepts that when you are reading. So if you see on the right hand side, you're seeing a droplet of water which is falling from a tap, which is spherical in shape. As you know, when you go to shop, you buy the clothes that which are your favorite color, right? It's not that you will buy something which is of not your favorite choice. But here again, we buy water as well. But somehow spherical shape happened to be my non-favorite shape. When I'm buying water, I don't want water to form a spherical shape in my home. I want some other shape like square. But irrespective of how much money I pay to the vendor, what I'm seeing is always it comes in spherical shape and he says he cannot give me a droplet which is in square in shape. Okay. So is there any reason to have a droplet to be spherical in shape? And then if you really understand what is going behind to get it, there are some fundamental concepts making them spherical. So let us make it very simple. You're seeing the droplet with your eyes. It means the size of the droplet must be bigger than 10,000 nanometers, right? That's what we have recollected in our, I mean, if I can recollect in the first slide. If you're seeing something with your human eye, it means it should be much bigger than 10,000 nanometers, right? And you know, even in the same slide, I've also told you the size of an hydrogen atom. And let us assume the size of the water molecule is also, with a lot of approximations, kind of 1 nanometer, which is not necessarily. But let us assume that for the sake of discussion, let us assume that the size of a water molecule is 1 nanometer. It means that you have almost 10,000 molecules in the droplet, 10,000 water molecules. Of course, you could
recalculate it in a slightly different way, what director suggested, because you know, basing on the molecular weight, if you take these things, how many number of Avogadro number of molecules that will be present in the water, in the water, the amount of water that you take. Using Avogadro number, I mean, you can obviously 18 grams corresponds to 6.03 to 10 power 23. You can calculate the weight of this, and then you can also calculate the number of water molecules present in the system. But for example, just to make sure that, let us assume that the smallest drop, what I'm seeing with my human eye, will have at least thousands and thousands of water molecules. Now, what you're going to see is the water molecules within the droplet are not going to be the same as the everyone, because let us assume that you have a droplet which is having around 1 lakh water molecules or 10 power, whatever the number. So if you see these 1 lakh water molecules, some of the water molecules are within the inside the droplet, and some of the molecules are on the surface of the droplet, right? So if you see from the water molecule perspective, the molecules which are well within sight, they are only interacting with other water molecules. They are not interacting with someone else. So they are so happy. But see, the problem is the water molecules which are on the surface, on one side, they're interacting with water. On the other side, they're interacting with air. Obviously, the water molecule doesn't want to interact with the outsiders. So they really wanted or anything other than the water. So what it'll try to do is, it'll try to reduce or optimize the situation. I mean, it's like one simple thing. There is space where three people can sit, and you have four people are there, and he's your friend. What you do? You want to accommodate him. You don't want him to stand all the way. Then you try to accommodate yourself and try to give him a seat. In a similar way, when you like people, you try to accommodate them. When you don't like, you don't want to accommodate them. Sometimes you'll be sitting in a park where supposed to be three people are sitting, but you're only sitting with two people because you don't want a third person who is an unknown person sitting next to you. The same thing happens with water molecules as well. This water molecule doesn't want to allow to interact with the air, but it wants to interact with other water molecules. So it wants to reduce its interaction with air. Then what it needs to do, it tries to shrink and come to a shape where the interaction between the water molecules would be minimum with air and maximum with the other water molecules which are within the droplet. So that's what we call them as surface tension. So it is the tension which is being posed on the molecules which are on the surface of the water. The water molecules which face the tension which felt by molecules on the surface are called as surface tension. Okay. So because of the surface tension, they will try to accommodate themselves to reduce the volume that they get in, and they will end up with a shape called spherical, which is energetically more favorable. Now, what we are doing is we are discussing about the content where you have the minimum interaction between the droplets within the water molecule. Now, how the droplet interacts with the substrate is what we call a hydrophilicity or hydrophobicity. If the water molecule wants to interact with the surface well, it means that if they're sticking so well, we call them as hydrophilic. Philic means nothing but love. It means that they're water-loving substrates. If you take the hydrophobic surface, those are the substrates where they don't interact with water. In a similar way, as I said, the way you behave when you don't want to accommodate your friends, or when the way you want to accommodate your people whom you know. So the substrates also behave in a similar way. Either the substrates could be philic and phobic. Basing on the nature of the substrate, the interaction with the water would change. And there are ways and means of measuring this contact angle. The contact angle is nothing but how much you have your substrate contacting with your substrate can be designed in two different states, called as Wenzel state and then Cassie-Bassot state, which I'm not going to go in detail. But otherwise, these are the behavior of a droplet on a rough surface could be explained in detail, or it could be understood on how these surfaces are behaving. So now, coming back to my old thing, all I said is, I wanted to make surfaces hydrophobic. That's my end target. What is the target for the day? Make hydrophobic surfaces. But how do I make it? I have no idea. Then do difference? It's a lot of sleep. Then what is the simple thing that I can do? Let me take the lot of sleep, place under the microscope, see how they are looking like, and if I can make them in the lab, the surfaces, then I'll be in a position to imitate the lot of sleep. So now if you see the images which are on the right hand side, these are coming up with the scanning electron microscope, which I've shown in my second slide, where you can clearly see the protrusions. The protrusions are nothing but those needles, and these needles are not allowing the water droplet to sit on the surface, making it hydrophobic. And it doesn't stop only there. I mean, it is as simple as that. I'm sorry, somebody is speaking, please. Yeah. Ms. Rajeshwari to mute. So, if I ask you to sit on a chair by placing thousands of needles, what you do? You don't feel like sitting, right? But I'm taking a stick and force you to sit. Then you do is you enact like you are sitting on a stick, but you won't touch the surface because you don't want to hurt yourself. The same thing is happening with the water droplet. Because of these protrusions coming in, it is not allowing, these protrusions are not allowing the water droplet to touch the surface. It's not only about the protrusions, there are many things available. If you see further, there are even smaller structures which are on the surface of each protrusion, making them even hydrophobic. And it's not only that, not only coming from the structure, there is also a chemical coating which is secreted on these leaves, which are called, which is like a wax. Like if you take candle and you put a droplet of water, you see it won't stick to the candle, the candle residue, right? In a similar way, if you have a wax, which is kind of a hydrophobic, it says the lotus leaf is behaving like the lotus leaf because of two reasons. One is the architecture or the nanostructures and the coatings which you are having. So if I can make an architecture like this in the lab, in principle, I'll be able to make these structures hydrophobic. So how do I do that? If I go to a laboratory who is a physicist or an engineer, they take a surface and they put a molecule like this, which is hydrophobic in nature. Hydrophobic is nothing but a carbon chain and hydrogen. If you have an oxygen there, it will become kind of hydrophilic, but I don't have anything, so it will become hydrophobic. So because of this hydrophobicity, water molecules don't want to interact. These are because of the difference in polarity and other aspects. So these hydrophobic heads makes them shielding to interact with the water molecules. The other way is, if you go to an organic chemist, they'll try to make the molecules like this, and they make films like this. You can see the roughness which is coming from here. The moment you see a droplet placing on that, you can see the angles are 150, 150 degrees, 156 degrees kind of a thing, suggesting that these are really hydrophobic and this will not wet the substrate. So if you come to a lab like mine, where we work on our materials, here also we want to emphasize the fact that if you have a lot of surface roughness, which is in the range of nano, the probability of them being hydrophobic is quite high, and this is how is one of those reports in the literature have shown. Want to give you a conclusion that if you're interested, one could really make these nanostructures, in lab, and that can be commercialized, and it could be. And these are one of those techniques which are seen here would have been used in the commercially available paints and the surfaces to make them what they are. And coming back to the other aspect that I would like to convey you is there is science in everything what we see around. It's only our interest to see them or not. For one example is the popcorn being popped. So this is something which most of us would have eaten or taken that, and most of us would like to have it again and again. But let us try to understand what makes this popcorn to pop. There's a very simple thing which is important here. This is how the structure of a popcorn, the inside seed would look like. They have an outer shell, they have a starch and the water. Okay? And when you use some amount of heat,
the water which is inside the shell make them vaporize, and then vapors will help well healthy pot to explode, gives you this popping effect. And this is something which is really important, because to not understand why sometimes we have a bad popcorn. You see, most of us would have experienced that some of the pops would not have popped well, we can't eat them. It's because the minimum amount of percentage of water that one would require within the shell is 14%. If it is got old or if it is not good, then there's a possibility that there is not enough amount of water or there's not amount of heat to make this reaction happen for the popcorn to pop. Okay, so it means that for everything what we see, there is some science underlying it, and it is our responsibility to understand. So whenever, next time when you go to a popcorn shop, you please think about when you are eating something which is not pop, then you can think of, okay, this pop would have been dry, there is not enough amount of water, or that guy would have heated in a hurry, he had not given the heat which is required, like 180 degrees kind of a thing. So these are the things you can conclude to tell yourself that what's really happening, so that you try to recall. So maybe I can finish in another 5-10 minutes with the interest of time, or the time is allocated. I'll be trying to provide one more aspect, and then we will have some time for discussion. So our interest is very simple. Whatever we are seeing in this movie is fictional, or can we do it using the science? So obviously, one could do it in science, otherwise one could fabricate it in lab, otherwise I would not have discussed for sure. What are the lessons or the inspiration for us to do that? We can learn how GKS echoes defy gravity, then we'll be even in position to extend our understanding from this to make a gloves like that. Okay? So what is that? So how does GKS defy gravity? Does it have any natural glue? If that is the case, our walls by now would have a lot of glue, and of course that's not true. Does it have any suction cups? And the answer is again no. So how do we know what is going there? And again, a primary understanding or minimum understanding on this bonding will help us to get how geckos crawl on the wall. So most of the times when we are in plus one, plus two, or to some extent in BSc, we will be comfortable about the covalent bonds, the ionic bond, and the metallic bond. Your teachers might have taught you a lot about it. But probably at the later stages of your bachelor's and the early stages of your master's, you'll also realize there is something called secondary interactions, which are equally important as the primary interactions, as good as primary interactions or the primary bonding. Those secondary interactions comes under the category like a hydrogen bonding and the van der Waals. The hydrogen bonding is responsible for what you're seeing, like the structure of DNA, what you're having, the double helix structure, the bondings are responsible. And the other important thing is called van der Waals. There's some problem with the van der Waals as well. I should have modified it, but yeah. So the other interactions are called van der Waals. You might not have heard of this van der Waals, but let me tell you in one line what van der Waals is. Have you ever thought what is the closest distance that you can bring two objects close? How much close one could bring? So most of the times when you are bringing two objects, you think they are touching with each other, but essentially there will be some distance which is called a van der Waals distance, beyond which you can't really push your systems together. Otherwise, these electronic repulsions or electron repulsions would come into the picture, which is not really stable. And the distance is approximately around 3.5 angstroms or 0.35 nanometers. When we're talking about van der Waals distance, it means that these are operating at a distances when the two objects are very close, where we are talking about at least 3.5 angstroms. So if you put two objects close to each other, then at some point of time, they will have van der Waals interactions where the distance is around 3.5 angstroms. Sometimes it could be 6 angstroms, sometimes it could be 10 angstroms. That's a different matter. But at least this is what you can bring them close. So what is van der Waals force and how these forces are different from the primary bonding? The advantage of this secondary bonding is, it's like, you know, if I have to put it in a very layman language, if I give you one stick and ask you to break it, you can easily break them. Okay? But if I give you a bundle of sticks and tie with a rope, okay, which I mean essentially summarizing with a bundle of sticks, and I ask you to break, it is not easy for you. Because you can break them individually, but not as a together. Because all of them will have, it will become difficult. In a similar way, van der Waals forces act in a similar direction, which is not the case with primary bonding, where the bonding energies and the bond strength remain same. In the case of van der Waals forces, if you increase the number of interactions with the surfaces, then the energy also increases. This is how it helps in getting the interlocking. So let us see. So as I said, my job is very simple, because I wanted to imitate geckos. I'll take the gecko leg and put it under a microscope. And if I see with my naked eye, this is how the gecko leg would look like. But my interest is to understand how these things are working. So I'll try to zoom in with the high microscopy, which I've used in the scanning electron microscopy, which I've used in third slide. I'll be zooming in different portions and try to understand how it is working or how the architecture is. So if I see this, to my surprise, the gecko legs, if I zoom this part, then what you call as cetal arrays. And again, if I zoom further, which we call as ceta, and if I zoom in further, there's spatula. So what is happening is there are millions and millions of these spatulas which are only having secondary interactions. These are only attractive forces or the van der Waals forces. There is nothing more than that, but they're having millions and millions. Each spatula is contributing to 40 micronewtons. But I have millions and millions of these spatulas, making them a good enough force to hold. So that's exactly what I need to do. If I can make these spatula kind of structures so that it will be interacting with the van der Waals forces, and these forces are attractive forces, and this can be summed up, and this will give you the interaction without any glue, without any suction cup. So now if I go to lab, what I need to do is I need to make a structure like this. I need to get a bigger one and the further smaller one, and I'll be able to hold without any glue. So this is how it's been realized. You see this? It's a tape which doesn't have any adhesive, and these are interacting because of the van der Waals, and it doesn't have those things when you put the other side. So this is how a non adhesive tape works. And people say, now you can think of whether it's a sci-fi or what could make, I mean, probably down the line, you might be positioned in buying these gloves where it will be holding your whole body weight, and you will be doing whatever you wanted to do, like crawling or, you're going to be next Superman kind of a thing, or Spider-Man, whatever. So, and these also having enough applications in NASA and other things where people have used to get this to reduce the space junk kind of a thing. So, I mean, I'll leave it to you what are the other possible applications, what could one could think of. Maybe before concluding my talk, I'll be discussing about one more aspect of the human head. What makes them curly? What's wrong with the curly head? Because, as I said, my interest is to let you know that there is some science in everything which we see around, and it is our responsibility to see that and to understand that. So, and most often, please remember that it is so difficult to attribute the things which you are observing to a given phenomena. It's usually a combination of things. So, can we think of any reason? Yes, it's all, as we all of you know, the head goes from the follicle, which comes out through the follicle, and the shape of the follicle decides the curly nature of the, or the shape of the head. If your follicle shape is centric, you'll get a striped head. If it is kind of wavy, because you're not allowing it to grow straight, so it will come in a way, instead of, if the follicle shape is completely perturbed and it is taking an odd shape like a half moon and ellipse kind of a thing, then the hair will grow sometime like this and some other time the other way. Actually, there's also an interesting thing. Maybe it's an exercise for you guys. Please see how much length your nail grows every day. Because you can easily calculate that if you know that how much time 1 centimeter of your nail grows, and per day how much you are growing. So that's also in nano dimensions. It's a very interesting aspect. So in a similar way here also, the hair grows of a certain nanometers every day. And then because of the shape, it takes different things. This is one of the reasons for that. Along with that, there is another reason also. There is something called sulfur-sulfur bonding, making them to have a curly hair. So that's why, again, putting it in a perspective, if you are if your sister or someone in your family going for curly hair, having curly hair, they wanted to straighten their hair. Then what they do is they try to apply the temperature, and then the temperature will make these bonds, they will break the bond temporarily, and that's how you are, you will become a straight hair. But again, these bonds are so permanent, at some point of time, they'll get their hair back. The curly nature will be back. That's the reason what they do is there's something called a chemical treatment where they try to do the leaching of the sulfur, and that's the reason that time it will become a permanent treatment. So this is a simple thing. Whatever you are using in dairy like be it soap, be it straightening of hair, is having enough amount of chemistry in that. All we need to do is we need to recollect them when we are seeing, so that we'll feel them better, so that we'll have, we don't have to remember anything, because you're already experiencing them on a daily life. So this is some aspect which I said will not be covering because of the time, as well as the director has covered most of the aspects. Now let us go to the final conclusions. Like this is some, if you ask me, this is my most favorite slide. The reason being is, what is the difference, or how different, how to differentiate an educated person to a non-educated person? Is simply because the person who is educated can visualize how things will change down the line, who has the ability to think. But most of the people who are uneducated will certainly lack the rational thinking. So now let us go to a situation where you are talking to your great-great-great-great-grandmother who died maybe 100 years before, where she didn't know either the first industrial revolution or second industrial revolution. And all of a sudden, for some reason, God has given you the power of talking to her. Then you start interacting with her. Then you tell her that I don't wash my clothes. I use washing machine. And then she'll be surprised because she doesn't know the second industrial revolution. She don't know about electricity. She doesn't know about anything. Because at that time, those are not available to major extent. And then you tell her that I don't walk or climb, because if you say lift, she won't understand, but you can definitely tell that I won't climb the mountain. I'll use lift, because she doesn't know the power, and I mean, she doesn't know about the electricity. So she'll be again surprised. But these are the things which are not really surprising you, because you are using washing machine daily, and you are using lift on a day in, day out. So it won't be surprised. Now, forget about that part. Now let's assume that you are talking to your great, 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 great grandchildren, maybe again after 100, 150 years. Okay? And then let's see what are the things that they're going to tell you which is going to surprise you. Because it may be because we are not using them. It doesn't mean that these are not possible. It's all because of the efforts of the people or the scientists working around the globe, across the globe, to make the human life sustainable, to make, to give more comfort to the human life. So one of the examples is molecular motors. This was not a fancy topic or anything. This already been awarded Nobel Prize in 2017 or 2018 to a chemist who has started working in this area, 2-3 chemists. So what are molecular motors? Now, if you wanted to climb your 6 floors in your building, you're using a lift. So why can't I have a lift within my body to travel and take the drug wherever I want? For that, if I can take a molecular motor, which is essentially a motor, but it's in nanometer scale, and you know, I told you the size of a body of a 6-foot person is 2 billion nanometers. Now you know this 1 nanometer motor needs to travel 2 billion nanometers if it wants to come from the feet to the head, right? But the advantage is, if I can ask the molecular motor to give injection in a specific place rather than by taking with the oral or through nerve, so it will make my life easy so that I don't have to take large amount of drugs into my body. So if you're getting a pain and you want to do an injection rather than doing it on outside, if you inject a motor within a body and ask the motor to do for you, it will do. I mean, it looks crazy now, but in principle, it may not be this crazy for the people if you are talking after 150 years. Another thing is gene editing. We know that there are many diseases which are coming because of the DNA which carries the information. We already knew and we already keep talking in our routine daily life that, okay, his father and mother had having specs, so this guy also would have that. So if you can do, or not necessarily with the specs, it could come from any genetic diseases or any genetic disorders. If we can edit the gene, then the disease would not be coming to the next generation. So this is what we are talking about, the gene editing. And of course, it may not be a good idea if it is not in the right hands of the people. Then there is a possibility that people would like to have their children who who looks like Salman, bats like Sachin, and sings like Rahman. So that's the kind of contribution that people would like to see, right? So of course, it all depends. It's like, again, nuclear energy, whether you wanted to use it for good purposes or bad purposes, it's up to us on how we want to do it. And already you are talking about the artificial intelligence, using it, which is an upcoming area where we are really contributing. Which is really upcoming. And 3D printing, printed electronics, you are already seeing some of the devices which are on the right-hand side, where the devices are coming because of the flexibility. You don't really have to worry whether if you throw your phone, it will still work, because it's not like an ITO-coated glass where it will break, right? So things would, the conclusion what I wanted to bring is, the future is going to be very exciting, and you can definitely contribute in your own way, not necessarily through chemistry perspective, because nanoscience is much broader than the chemistry, physics, materials, engineering, biology. It goes beyond the horizons, and in principle, one could contribute to any area of your choice and see that the coming generations would be benefited because of your contributions. Yeah, with this, again, thank the organizer for giving me this opportunity, and I'll be happy to take if you have any questions. Thank you. Hello.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for an elaborate explanation. Sir, I just wanted to ask you something which you wanted to delete, actually. One small slide I could see, sir. Why do the old books smell, sir?
Ah.
I saw that slide, but you didn't have the time to go through it, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, fine. I'll come back to you. See, the reason is, I really wanted to discuss things which are, one thing, I mean, coming back to, yeah, are you able to see the slide?
Yes, we are able to see, sir.
Yeah, see, the reason why I wanted to, because if you go to library, and I don't know how often this generation is going to library, you get all kinds of smells. To be honest, even when I'm doing my bachelor's degree, I was not kind of aware of this. And later, for some odd reasons, we got to realize that it is because of the breakdown of the cellulose or the paper, because paper is nothing but cellulose. With time, that over time, this gradual breakdown of cellulose and lining in paper produces large number of different organic molecules. When I read that, I felt it is so interesting. Then I thought, okay, if I don't know, I also assume that others might also like it. So it's all just because of decomposing the paper and giving those organic molecules, and people have identified them. It could be toluene, ethylbenzene, benzaldehyde, furfural, and that's the reason I've shown an image which are degraded books. We think everything is stable. It's almost like, organic things at some point of time, they break down because of the stability issues, and it won't happen on a day one. It could be happening in 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, and particularly the smell is because of the molecules which are coming because of the breakdown in the cellulose and lignin, which are the lignin, which are the constituents of the paper. And these are already extracted, and they have found the proofs to, and these molecules will emit in the library, and then you are inhaling them.
We were all the time thinking it could be because of some mites which are growing and cause, bronchital allergies, sir. That's what we thought. So it is actually the chemicals.
Yes. I mean, as I said, I really wanted to restrict myself to comment for any smell or any reason attributing to given thing. You might be true in what you said, but this is also one of those things. I don't want to rule out other options, because see, even in the case of that hydrophobicity, it's not only about the protrusions, it's about also having the wax. In the case of curly hair, it's not only about the conical shape of this one, it's also about the sulfur-sulfur bonding. So there could be the contribution coming from what you're saying, but also this also could contribute. I really don't want to pinpoint, no, this is the only reason. Because for that, I have to be utterly sure. And I at this point of time, I can say that these are for sure, but what you're saying also could contribute.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for such an interesting lecture. With the title, The New and Big Science of Small, Nanoscience. I think half the people who are listening, the student community, I think should take up nanoscience as their specialty. It looks like that to me, because so very interesting. And the, as you have put it quite rightly, this is going to be the base of all branches of science. Today, I think gone are the days when we talk about macromolecules. Now we are all talking about nanomolecules. So if there are any questions, students, please unmute yourself and ask them.
And
otherwise, we will proceed.
And not necessarily you have to worry about what we discussed. Anything general is also fine because it's an interactive session. I don't really want to restrict myself on what we discussed. If I can definitely give my opinion or comments if I know. Otherwise, I would say, sorry, this is not my domain kind of a thing. So it's all up to you, the listeners, or whatever, anything you wanted to bring in, you can just bring in and let's see whether we can discuss about it.
So if you say that, sir, I'll be the first one to ask, sir, when are we going to introduce nanoscience as the branch of specialization in MSc courses, sir? Like we have organic, inorganic, and, you know, analytical science. Still, nanotechnology hasn't made its way as a specialty. Is it because the subject matter is not enough to go through the semesters, entire semester syllabus? Or is there any other reason which is holding us back, sir?
Perfect. It's an interesting topic, and a lot of people are debating on this. And there are universities which are offering BTech and MTech in nanotechnology. There are many places. But I personally believe that is not the best way for a student to take the career to start with, because nanoscience is integral part of every subject. If you don't have basics in a given area, you can't really take it forward in nano. So you need to have a basics either in physics or chemistry or in chemical engineering or electrics or electronic engineering.
Ramkrishna.
And then from there...
Ramkrishna. Sorry, Ramkrishna, to bother you, just to give a precise answer. Yes, I agree with you, but there are some universities already they have MSc in nanoscience and technology. MSc first year and second year. We do get many applications wherein they clearly say that MSc in nanoscience and technology. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I started with. There are courses BTech and MTech are being offered, but that may not be a great way to start with, because you one need to be very clear in the fundamentals, either in one of those topics, and then the further development could be taken care of. Of course, this is my personal opinion. If a course curriculum can be made in such a way that the basics of physics and chemistry were well taught, and this use as a specialization in the last year or something like that, it would make more sense, because the moment you already, let us assume that you're talking about nanoscience, you're talking about highly sophisticated instruments, and all of them will work on very fundamental principles like Michelson interferometer, for that matter, in the case of AFM. So if they don't know exactly what is that, how that one would know how the instrument would work? So the basics of the things should be certainly clear for people in one of the domains, and then it will be easy to take it from their own way and could be extended in the domain that they would like to take. I mean, of course, it's my completely personal thing, and there could be many other opinions for this.
Yes, sir. Even I agree to that. If you, they don't have fundamentals, they cannot go up to the top of the pyramid. They need the fundamentals. Maybe a little like spectroscopy, how we have introduced in bits and pieces to start with in smaller doses. Maybe that can be done in order to make people aware that there is so much there to read and so much to do research in.
I agree. One should go with a calibrated approach.
Correct. Correct, sir. That's right. Thank you so much, sir. So I request a BSc fourth semester student, Mr. Jonathan Jesuraj, for giving the vote of thanks, and thank you properly from the side of the students and the staff, sir, who are attending this. Jonathan, will you take over?
Warm and graceful afternoon to our most valued speaker, Dr. HSSR Mate sir, Principal Dr. L.D. Horakere sir, the Management Committee of PC Javan Science College, worthy teachers and everyone gathered here. I, Jonathan, a student of PC Javan Science College, am privileged to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of our college and the entire fraternity of the Department of Chemistry. I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to the Center for Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, Bengaluru, for organizing the seminar. Today, we had the opportunity of hearing from Dr. HSSR Mate sir. Your words have enlightened and sparked a curiosity in us and will surely encourage us in our future prospects in nanoparticle study and science as a whole. My heartfelt gratitude to sir for sharing his invaluable knowledge with us and for setting aside your time from your busy schedule. We are grateful to you, sir. A special mention to our respectful principal, Dr. L.D. Horakere sir, for supporting and encouraging learning arrangements such as these. I would also like to thank the people who work behind the scenes, including our proactive and dedicated staff. Last and certainly not least, I thank all the participants for your active involvement in today's session. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you very much. Dr. Patil, would you like to conclude? I request all the students to come back tomorrow with the same energy and strength so we can continue with the two more talks, which will be as interesting as the talks were today. Extremely interesting, sir. So I hope the students will come back. Dr. Patil may say a few words before we wind up.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon, all the resource persons and participants. So the two sessions from morning are very much useful for us, especially the dress to function nanoparticle synthesis was very attractive and motivating for our students. And the talk given by Dr. HSS Ramakrishna Mate sir on nanoscience, the new big science of small. Very inspiring, sir. Thank you very much for all the resource persons, madam, and Yamagat sir, for organizing this and giving a highly intellectual address to all our students and staff. Thank you, madam, and thank you, sirs, all the resource persons for this, for the two excellent sessions. Thank you, madam.
Hello. Shall we end the meeting, sir?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
Thank you so much. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir.